Continuing with the second keynote presentation. We have the schedule standing for today. You're aware of the circumstances. I'm assuming many of you are familiar with his work, either with his work or with him personally, or both. What is important for Stanimir as a theoretician, as a philosopher, to mention in the introduction is that he combines the new forms of realism in philosophy, the new materialism as well, and in particular Laurel's non-philosophy or non-standard philosophies, or similar to my own approach to philosophy, with Marxism. He also deals with issues of gender, so it's one of the major themes. While operating with this theoretical or philosophical traditions, he's a PhD candidate at the Central European University in Budapest, and he's about to complete his thesis on the concept of Kora, dealt with from the Orwellian standpoint, as well as through classical the standpoint of classical philosophy, and philology partly as well. So that is mostly his theoretical or philosophical focus currently, and he has published a lot on these topics in the past few years. So I give
It's interesting only in the sense that I ended up being able to present something today which is very fresh, and I haven't presented this material, and it's nice that it's actually happening in some way. I was asked to write for a huge international project, a big volume that's gonna be published by the end of this year by Routledge. A volume contributed to the 150th anniversary of the publication of Volume 1 of Marx's Capital, and I wrote the chapter on Bulgaria. But what I'm going to try to do today is, because dealing with and historicizing national context is a tricky business, I'm going to try to reduce the big chunk of historical reconstruction, and I'm going to try to make this presentation more about Bulgarian Marxism in general, as it is influenced in particular by Marx's political economy, and not so much on a particular interpretation of capital. There is such an interpretation, I'm going to go to that at the end of the lecture. But this is just as an introduction, and today I'm not dealing with non-philosophy, I'm not dealing with gender theory, I'm just dealing with a particular reception of Marx, and what I want to do is make an overview of something that I, in the research I was doing on the Bulgaria chapter, I ended up realizing how inextricable the Soviet influence is. And that's truism, but the effect of this truism is interesting, and I'm going to go in some details about that. So basically, the focus of this lecture is the following: the Bulgarian reception of Marx's Capital. I'm going to discuss in several ways the Soviet influence, and here we're talking about mostly Capital Volume 1 and 2, Volume 1 to 3, excluding Volume 4. And what I was interested in was, of course, is there any original reception? And I'm going to insist on talking about Bulgarian Soviet, whether it's a dash or a slash, is a question of interpretation. But I'm going to insist that there is no Bulgarian originality per se in the reception of Capital, and that's mostly a political story. So the rough historical timeline is this. There are three periods I'm going to try to run through. So there's quite a lot of material. The first one is the one that I decided to mark from 1878, which is the national liberation of Bulgaria from the Ottoman Empire, to 1891, and 1891 marks the Buzluca Congress, which is the founding of the first Bulgarian Socialist Party by Blagojev upon his return from Russia. And then this period runs through 1929, which marks the beginning of the illegal period of the Bulgarian Communist Party. So until 1929, the Bulgarian Communist Party was a legal entity. And then, I'm sorry, this is a typo, it's 1944, not 1945, when the September coup d'etat happened and the communists took over. And then the second period is 1944, 1990, and then the third period is contemporary Marxism in Bulgaria, of which I'm not going to say a lot. It's impossible, I'm going to mostly read, but interject a lot of stuff in between. It's the most important thing to say in the beginning is that the mention of Russia is unavoidable in Bulgaria's reception of capital. The Bulgarian, for example, the Bulgarian collected works edition of Marx and Engels and the edition of Capital Volume 1 to 4 follows very closely the post 1984 mega edition, the German mega edition, which hosts Capital Volume 1-4. So in the Bulgarian case, they are translated from the Russian mega edition. The Russian edition that's translated from the German Ditzverlag edition. So unsurprisingly, the Russian influence comes from one of the founders of the first socialist party in political history, which is Dmitry Blagojev, a Bulgarian who lived in St. Petersburg until 1885, and who then was extradited in Bulgaria and became the first translator of Capital in Bulgaria, first translator in the entirety of Capital One, that is. So it is thanks to the episode of Blagojev's appearance on the radar of the Russian Tsarist police that the reception of Capital actually kicks off. You know, the Russian Tsarist police took interest in his activities and they extradited him back to Bulgaria. And this is how Bulgarian Marxism actually started. So Blagojev's return to Bulgaria led him to popularize Marxist work and in effect to create Bulgarian Marxist historiography. In 1885, he began publishing the first socialist journal, Savremeni Pokazalets. In 1897, he established the journal Novo Vreme, titled after the German Die Neue Zeit. He was the editor-in-chief until 1923. And then this journal, which is a very important journal to this very day, ceased to exist and then reappeared in 1947. 47-48 is an important period, I'm going to come later too. It's interesting to note that the journal Novo Vreme is still being published by the Bulgarian Socialist Party to this very day. So it's almost uninterrupted with these several years. And it's still the official theoretical organ. The Bulgarian Socialist Party still maintains this theoretical organ, which used to be the one of the Bulgarian Communist Party. So as you can see, Blagojev first published in 1905, only part one of Capital Volume 1, and then in 1909, he published the entire Volume 1. So the first decade after Bulgaria's liberation from the Ottoman Empire in 1878 saw also the first steps towards the development of a distinct Bulgarian class consciousness in what scholars have called party without proletariat. Despite the catastrophic historiographical thesis prevalent in Bulgaria's early communist period, which posits that the Ottomans retarded social-cultural mobilization, it is realistic and reliable to claim that Bulgaria's role in the first wave of socialist political mobilization, toying with Marx's ideas, was in line with the historical developments immediately after the national liberation. And with regards to the dispersal and publishing of Marx's ideas in this early period, 1891, as I mentioned, as the year of establishing the Bulgarian Socialist Democratic Party, Capital was initially not the central text of concern. That's an interesting bit. The first translation of Capital was partial, not by Blagojev, and it appeared in 1895, translated by Bakalov, Georgi Bakalov. As an appendix to the translation of Wage, Labor and Capital. and it was featuring only chapter 32 of Capital One, the historical tendency of capitalist accumulation. And then the whole period, this period between 1895 till 1905, so these two different translations from the Russians, the Russian and three editions of Wage, Labor and Capital in particular. And I'm mentioning this because the Wage, Labor and Capital publication was it's a 1891 Russian edition of the Engels edition, which then became popular in Bulgaria. So even at this very early stage, you can see how Marxism is being is migrating to Bulgaria through Russian editions, etc. So at the time, Bulgarian revivalists or Vazrodensi were avid readers of progressive literature, which was published in Russian, because places such as Moscow, Odessa and Kiev, they gradually came to compete with Constantinople as the intellectual and educational hotbed of Bulgarians and the Bulgarian elites after the national liberation. So apparently this literature mattered a lot, and though this is not universally true for socialists, for example, some of the other people I'm going to mention, Yanko Sakazov, which became one of the rivals of Blagojev, was educated in Geneva and was very close to Plekhanov. He actually introduced the work of Plekhanov in Bulgarian. So that's not universally this topography and Bulgarian intellectuals is not universally Russian influenced. So with regards to the early phase of socialist publishing in Bulgaria in general, one early author, Bulgarian author, notes, I quote, that there hasn't been in new Marxism that has inserted such a mighty influence in the hearts and minds among the Bulgarian youth, end of quote. It is such enthusiasm that produced two partial translations of Capital Volume 1 and one partial translation of Volume 2. Volume 1's chapter 32, as I mentioned, was translated by Bakalov, so Blagojev's first translation, which was also partial, was published 10 years after. Thus, there is mere 2 years between the decisive 1903 split in what is it's a very important split in Bulgarian political history between what is called broad and narrow socialists. I'll come to this later. Now I will turn to the two major and first full translations, and I'm not gonna speak so much about this, but I wanna show how the introduction of Marxism in particular and capital and political economy, Marxist political economy, is intimately connected with Bulgarian political parties and their history. In general, we can divide the publishing history of Capital in two substages that fall under the general period, 1886 until 1944. The first period is the legal period of the Bulgarian Communist Party until 1923, which is marked by the so-called September Uprising. And the second is the illegal period of the Bulgarian Communist Party, which is 1923-1944, that is until the seizure of power on September the 9th, 1944. And the publishing history is more than intimately intertwined with the vagaries of Communist Party lines. Now, it's important to mention that Blagojev was versed in several languages and could offer a direct translation to the avid Bulgarian audience awaiting a translation of the Capital. And he did translate directly from the German, which is extremely important, as I will show later, because later on the systematic publishing of Capital in Bulgaria abandoned the direct translations from German, and they switched to retranslation from Russian. So the period is marked, in general, after the publication of both the Blagojev and Bakalov translation, this period afterwards is marked by the arrival of Todor Pavlov, who is an extremely important person in Bulgarian philosophy. Some of you might know him. He used to be one of the three major figures that were supposed to define what used to be communist or socialist philosophy in the Soviet satellite bloc, at least, together with Lukács, who wrote the Aesthetics, and Pavlov was commissioned to basically write a sort of party line gnosiology. and he's famous for his work, The Theory of Reflection. So he did arrive at this point in the early 1930s on the scene of Bulgarian philosophy of Marxism. In 1990, he joined Blagojev's line of socialism, which is the so-called narrow socialists. The broad socialists are defined in general. Broad socialism in Bulgarian political history means revisionism, Berstein. So as early as 1919, he joined Blagojev's narrow socialist the narrow socialist joining the Third International. In this time, Pavlov, who then became the first regent of the Kingdom of Bulgaria after the 1944 coup, and the most influential Bulgarian Marxist philosopher, deep into the early 1960s, he had just received amnesty in 1929 for being complicit with the Sveta Nedelja bombing. It's a historical event in Bulgarian history. It was a failed coup organized by the communists. After having edited the two translations, both Bakalov and Blagojev, he fled to Russia in 1932, where he became a professor in dialectical materialism, DMAT, in Moscow at what used to be called then the Institute of Red Professorship. And he came back home only in 1936. Unlike other translators and Marx followers in Bulgaria, Pavlov did experience the fury and brutality of the Bulgarian anti-communist reaction, being arrested in 1923 and then in 1925, and he was interned in various camps in the period later in 1941 till 1943. So Pavlov's influence and power will be felt for the years to come. In fact, he was already shaping the reception of Marx and the direction of Marxism in the tumultuous illegal period of the Bulgarian Communist Party. Yet, I cannot emphasize enough how important is the fact that both Blagojev's and Bakalov's translation of Capital Volume 1 were made from the German. And this fact should be juxtaposed to the Russian literary influence that the ilk of Pavlov brought with their reintegration in Bulgarian society after 1944. The history that follows is a direct reflection of a kind of gnoseological isomorphism between satellite loyalty in both the party and in the language shaped by the institutional Marxist-Leninist establishments derivative of Moscow. Given that Blagojev was able to provide a direct translation of Capital, and given that Pavlov could edit the translation, most of the translations most likely in comparison to the Russian translation, this is what I found in my research, it is unfortunate, though somewhat expected, that the publishing history of Capital Volume 1 after Pavlov and his re-editions will rely almost exclusively on the Russian translations. So what followed after Blagojev and Bakalov's translation was, textually speaking, an unfortunate turn of events towards the Russian gravitational literary pool. Unfortunate not because the Russian translations are flawed, though ideologically they will certainly be, but because the Bulgarian audience was able to read translations from the original from early on, 1905. The fact that Bulgarian and Russian are from the same Slavic sprachbund, that at the late 19th century there was already a Russophile movement, which certainly bore an imprint on the Bulgarian Marxist vocabulary, does not explain away the party line followed later by the Bulgarian Communist Party to use Russian editions and retranslations. And whatever Pavlov had to learn from these two translations by Bakalov and Blagojev, it could not and was not integrated in the future editions overseen by the party. So there is a third period in the dissemination of Capital and reception, and it opens after 1944. We can call this the systematic period. There is no edition of Capital between Pavlov and his overseen translations. That is to say, from 1931 till 1948, with a full retranslation of Capital Volume 1 from the Russian, commissioned by the Bulgarian Communist Party. So there is this interesting gap between 1944 and 1948, where there was a lot of basically party management. that had to be done, and reorganization of some of the internal opposition, for example, the Bulgarian Agrarian Party, BZNC. So in this period, there was no the party wasn't over-occupied so much with dealing with the scientific establishment and dissemination of Marx, but that changed in 1948. So before I continue my discussion on the Russian legacy, I first need to introduce a little bit the tumultuous history of the Bulgarian Communist Party in the first few years after the 1944 events, in order to explicate the political and ideological intimacy channeled through Marxist appropriation. So as I tried to indicate, Bulgarian political organizations considered communist started off on a social democratic platform. So the term communism appears much later. The transition to the political label communism is, of course, intimately connected with the dissemination of Marx and Engels' ideas and political mobility. The founding moment is, as I mentioned, the 1891 Vuzlaja Congress. In the legal period, in 1990, the Blagojev narrow socialist line decidedly identified with Lenin and the Bolshevik line and changed the long-contested label social democracy to a new name, which is the Bulgarian Communist Party, narrow socialists. So there was a Leninist line, however, that did not arrive wholeheartedly among the narrow socialist circles. The Leninist hardliners, the so-called left faction within the narrow socialists, had something to do with the gradual militarization of the party around the time of the 1918 Vladaya uprising, another failed communist event, a coup that lasted until the mid-30s. So, yet the Blagojevist line did not support the next coup, which was in 1923. So the Blagojevist narrow socialist one is a weird line, because on the one hand they wanted to take over all the way till the events in 1944, but on the other hand they were anti-militarists. And Blagojev's line was, narrow socialist line was interesting in that way, that it was both Bolshevik, so this line was gradually Bolshevized, but they didn't want to take the power from a top with the guns. So given the later Russian publishing influence, it can never be explained via Blagojev's attitude toward Russia and his sentiments toward Russia, as he remained critical of Russian revolutionary paternalism, defending himself from attacks by fellows such as Zakhary Stoyanov on the pages of the journal Borba, etc., etc. The next failed September 23 uprising in 1923 against the Alexander Tsankov regime saw the opening of the so-called illegal period. And the radical turn, there was a radical turn to the right within the so-called social democrats in Bulgaria. So the broad socialist then gradually became they become self-recognize themselves as closer to the Bulgarian agrarians. And Bulgarian agrarians were never really very, doctrinally close to the narrow socialists. The Bolshevization of the narrow socialists is the byproduct of the 1924 law for the protection of the state, which deemed all communist organizations illegal. The influence of Georgi Dimitrov and Vasil Kolarov, who returned in Bulgaria in 1923, was felt in their de-escalation strategy. And this line was not irrelevant for the Blagojevists. After a gradual relaxation, which came from the replacement of Tsankov by the government of Andrei Lyapchev, in 1927 the Workers' Party was founded with its official organ Rabotnicheskoe Delo, which was the official paper of the Bulgarian Communist Party until 1990, which will be the successive... In the mid-30s, the so-called left sectarians were isolated by the Blagojevist line, and after its first decade of existing, the Workers' Party and the narrow socialist merged in one party, and now they became the Bulgarian Workers' Party. Now, the systematic publishing of Capital can be credited to the 1948 edition, as I mentioned. The first full edition of all volumes 1 to 4 was realized in the period 1984 till 1966. So it took quite a lot of time. Volume 1 does not mention the name of the translator. It was a very chaotic edition, but it was definitely made from the Russian. The second period of publishing a full edition of Capital could be credited to 1950 to till 1969. I'm not going to go into the technical details of this bibliographical data because it's not so interesting, but there were parallel editions that are very confusing, and sometimes reconstructing this is hard, also because as I said, there was this particular time gap where the party wasn't sure what they want to do with theory in the first year. So now I want to return to discussing the Russian / Soviet influence. The first truly systematic edition of Capital is volumes 23-25 from 1968. This edition, which runs from 1948 till 1966, is the full edition. But it still cannot be labeled very systematic. Now, before 1944, the Marx Engels Lenin Institute in Moscow had already started publishing what used to be called Archive Marx and Engels, which is the first Russian edition of MEGA, so to speak, and which was reconceptualized after the war and the name was dropped. Nothing published in this archive was ever translated into Bulgarian, so the Bulgarian systematic edition follows closely the second Russian edition, which kicked off in the 1950s. Unlike the Russian mega edition by the Mels Institute, so in the 50s it becomes Marx, Engels, Lenin, Stalin Institute, which is parallel to the German Ditzberlach edition, the Bulgarian one has only one edition. The Russian second mega edition originally was planned into 39 volumes plus one specialized volume, which was published in the 50s with a selection of early Marx and Engels writings, and this is the first time when in Russian they published the philosophical economic manuscripts, 1955. Volumes 23 from 26 include all four volumes of Capital, and as part of the de-Stalinization process, Later on, the Mels Institute decided to include additional 11 volumes in the mega edition that will include the Grundrisse and the economic writings of the 1860s. So this whole boring bibliographical history is important to understand how the Soviet influence becomes important for the Bulgarians and what would be the so-called originality of Bulgarian Marxism. One more, perhaps boring page, but it's also important. The Bulgarian mega edition is often seen as translated from the German. That's a very strange preconception in the Bulgarian academy to this very day. And there are two reasons behind this. The first reason is that because readers read these in the Russian translated and anonymous prefaces to the editions, stating that the translation is made from the German, while the Bulgarian translation follows the Russian volumes. The Bulgarian mega edition and its publisher, all the way down to 1990, volume 49, the last volume 50 wasn't ever published, is extremely confusing in this way. To make things worse, readers are confused as later volumes from the 1980s do state that some texts are translations from the German and names of Bulgarian translators are provided. For example, there is this very interesting person who was extremely knowledgeable. I was able to check this, whose name is Karol Sabitaev, who certainly translated from the German, but this only began happening in the 1980s. So the whole translation strategy of the Bulgarian Communist Party from 1948 until the 1980s was basically retranslations from the German. And thanks to the influence of this person, Karol Sabitaev, they actually started translating some of the texts in the later mega volumes in Bulgarian from the German. Expertise in German, likelihood is that there is no actual translation from the German. So I spoke with two university professors and it was very confusing. Some of them told me, yeah, he did translate from the German. Another one told me, well, he didn't actually translate from the German. He did check the original the original German text with the Russian translation and the Bulgarian translation then. So in this sense, you can say that probably the translations were less ideological, because this would be the post-communist assumption. And I don't know if in other cultures, but this would be interesting to hear now, maybe, or in the discussion. I don't know if in other translation culture this is true about Russian, but in Bulgarian, German language, in the case of translation of Marx and Engels, was used the so-called sverka. In Bulgarian it's called sverka. It means corroboration. It will be interesting to hear other national contexts whether this was happening or not. So what was the conjuncture for all of this? It involves two factors. First, the satellite structure of the Bulgarian communist science since 1947, and the science community's parochialism, stemming from close institutional collaboration with Russian educational and scientific elite entities. In short, the efforts of Bulgarian Germanists such as Karol Sabitaev should be seen as being harnessed to prevent translation whims from the Russian, and not towards building a conceptual translation in line with the Bulgarian lexis and local Marxist concept making. Now, the second Russian mega edition, which started in the 1950s with the Russian translations of Capital, Volume 1 to 3, were published in Volume 23, 24, 25, and this is the de-Stalinized Russian edition. Going back to the Bulgarian translation from 1948 from the Russian, and since this translation served as the primary one for the Bulgarian Communist Party, the question is whether subsequent editions corroborated in any way with the second Russian mega edition which ran from 1960 till 1962. Now, the question is easily answered if we are able to identify which Russian translation did the translator actually use in the 1948 translation. And the answer is the following. The first Russian translation of Volume 1 appeared in 1972 in St. Petersburg, and it was the first translation was by Lopatin and Danielson. It is well known that Marx's opinion of that Russian translation was very enthusiastic, and thus might have also influenced the Bulgarian Marxists. However, Lenin preferred the other later translation, which was carried out by Ivan Skvortsov Stepanov, Alexander Bogdanov, and Vladimir Bazarov. The translation runs from 1907 till 1909, and the whole translation was overseen by Skvortsov Stepanov. The Bulgarian 1948 translation and the entire Marxist lexis, the entire Marxist concept making was based on the retranslation from Russian of that Skvortsov Stepanov translation. Politically, this actually makes a lot of sense, given that the left sectarianism among the Workers' Party at the time prevailed, so that there is a sound parallelism between the Blagojevist Bolshevik Party loyalty on the one hand and ideological intellectual production post-1944 on the other hand. The translation which was overseen, the Russian translation which was overseen by Skvortsov Stepanov, was included twice in the full Russian mega edition and so many individual editions all the way to 1988, and became the standard model for what in socialist publishing was known, as I mentioned, as sverka, or corroboration. Yet in the Bulgarian case of Capital, after 1948, it was German which served as the contact language for sverka, while the Lenin licensed translation, the one by Skvortsov Stepanov, dominated the conceptual reality of Bulgarian Marxism. All this despite Blagojev's knowledge of German, whose translation was not picked for re-editing and republication purposes, despite Bakalov's knowledge in German, despite the abilities of someone like Karol Sabitaev, the Germanist I mentioned, and finally, despite Blagojev's suspiciousness of Russian revolutionary orthodoxy. He was he became politically conscious in Russia, but he was never the kind of Russophile that you would expect him to be historically. Even Bakalov and his popular translation from the Russian of Wage, Labor and Capital, which as I mentioned was the first Marx text that was translated in Bulgarian, even this translation was replaced by a later one from 1947 by another translator, which was recommissioned from the Bulgarian Communist Party. Okay, so this is probably the boring part of the lecture, and I'm now gonna switch to talking more systematically about the reception of Marx in after 1944 in general, and then a little bit after 1990. Given the Russian influence, Georgi Dimitrov and his precept from 1946 that we need our own Marxist philosophy of our history as we need bread and air sound dispiriting. In turn, historians and philosophers will blame Dimitrov's words for the histmat methodology superimposed on the Bulgarian historiography and Marxism in a kind of secondary effect of that dispiriting. And if 1943 was something of an illusionary toll after Stalin's death, then the local reignition of scientific enthusiasm had to find its own institutional limitations. Thus, the very same 1943 saw the founding of the Institute for the History. You can see on the PowerPoint the brief history of the scientific establishments in Bulgaria that actually controlled the publication of Marx and Engels and all the other party literature. 1943 saw the founding of the Institute for the History of the Bulgarian Communist Party, which was preceded by the earlier Central Party School in 1945, which in 1957 became the Stanky Dimitrov Higher Party School. The Institute reported directly to the party's Central Committee. The same became true for the Stanky Dimitrov School in 1979, when it transformed into the Academy of Social Sciences and Social Management, which, with its 10 institutes, was hardly distinguishable from the Bulgarian Communist Party. And this is interesting because not all the scientific institutes, apart from the ASSSM, were actually that close to the party. The other interesting thing about this institute is that many of the post-1990 intellectuals and neoliberal propagandists of shock doctrine, etc., were trained in this institute from early 70s onwards. So the post-Stalinist intellectual and ideological life in Bulgaria is inextricable from the history of this institute, the ASSSM. The importance of this observation is that it garnered an undercurrent in the reception of Marx, which will have lasting consequences to this very day. The opposition between the young Marx and the mature Marx, an Althusserian distinction that had its own not-so-French life in Bulgarian Marxism. That is to say, Althusser, for example, appeared in a couple of articles by a female scholar, Zdravkova, is her name, in the 70s, but without any particular mention of how should I say this, the Althusserian uniqueness. He was introduced in two articles that I was able to consult without the dramatism of his own interpretation, so to speak. To understand the reception of Marx's political economy and the way it intersected with the Soviet satellite notion of historical materialism, there are several avenues that could be pursued. This is because, in my opinion and in my research, it isn't possible to distinguish a distinct Bulgarian reception of capital. Therefore, what I try to do is to seek originality in various institutional and genre outlets, and through them, to try and explain the retardation of that originality. I will discuss, so in general we can discuss three periods, the pre-1944 literature, the post-1944 literature, and the post-1990 literature. I will now speak a little bit on the pre-1944 literature. The seizure of power in 1944, 1948, and constructing party elites and scientific establishment thereafter didn't produce an original interpretation of political economy or critique of capitalism until the mid-80s, as late as the mid-80s. The Bulgarian scholar Dimitar Tsatsov claims that we can distinguish three types of Marxism, the narrow socialist, the broad socialist, and the neo-Kantian Marxists. They are best represented by Rakowski in Bulgaria. These three types of Marxism will eventually lead to the division of dogmatists versus revisionists, which is connected to debates on materialist genetics and not Marxist political economy. So the dividing scientific line in Bulgaria arrived through the arrival of genetics, Marxist genetics, and Lysenkovism, and it didn't happen through discussions on political economy that are derivative of a reception of capital. Post-Stalinist Bulgaria didn't see an interest in questions of human subjectivity, which received a relative popularity among other satellite countries such as Hungary and Poland. On the contrary, the Bulgarian Communist Party heaped scorn on international oppositions throughout Warsaw Pact countries and, in line with its own 1956 April plenum, and playing holier than thou with the USSR, indulged in demonstrative demonization of the Hungarian revolt. Thus, as Tsatsov, the scholar I just quoted, claims, one of the characteristics of Bulgarian Marxism until the late 60s included, the late 60s included, when a theoretical reorganization around the topic of activity, the philosophy of activity happened, is the lack of interest in humanitarian and anthropological questions. Emphasis was put on social ideological questions and those that are ontological epistemological. Tsatsov calls this hard philosophizing, which transformed into party-licensed apologetic of Stalinist dogmaticism. Now, I will proceed now speaking a little bit about the literature, but quickly and in fragments. The literature in general can be subdivided into original monographs, articles and essays published in periodicals and edited volumes and conference proceedings. The first translation of Capital Volume 1 was preceded by introductory readings. Translations of Gabriel Deville, first his Evolution of Capital, published in 1892. Why I'm going back all this time again? This was interesting because it was published by somebody who was called Petr Motafov, who was a relative to Sava Motafov. Sava Motafov was Siro Mahomil. I don't know if in Macedonian, Siro Mahomil, Macedonia, was it a phenomenon? Siro Mahomilstvo. It's the English term of this is pauperophilia. It's a particular kind of Christian sect that early on intersected with Russian, with early forms of Russian socialism. I'm just curious if this was also a phenomenon in Macedonia later on. And they were representative of so-called pauperophilia, who were among the first group which tried to organize politically. Some of them merged with the Blagoev Party of 1891. The Siro Mahomil organization was broken up in the 1890s, but apparently this didn't prevent others to continue with their publishing activities, now that Blagoev's party was in existence. There was a second book by Gabriel Deville that was published by Bakalov, this time in 1900, his Outline of Marx's Capital. And another later and popular read was published by Julian Borhardt. He has this famous Digest of the Capital. This was published in 1923. Subsequent literature from the interwar period and going into the illegal period of the Bulgarian Communist Party had to do mainly with the applicability of Marxism in general and the puzzling question whether an agrarian country like Bulgaria needs to first produce its own proletariat in order to produce its own regional Marxism. This was the dominating question in the 1920s and the 1930s. Basically, the broad socialists were, their thesis was that we do not need to invent violently our own proletariat, this was their interpretation, to then be able to produce Marxism. This is in effect the debate between Blagoev and people like Janko Sakuzov and Zahari Stoyanov. These debates did not produce anything original regarding the application of Marxist political economy or the production of a distinct understanding of class relations dominated by a national bourgeoisie in Bulgaria. These were debates that played out dilemmas of national consciousness as they related to the future anterior of class relations, as the broad socialists had this. The very existence of the narrow socialists splinter was predicated on the idea that it is impossible and undesirable to produce a proletariat in order to then produce an authentic Marxism. I'm sorry, I'm talking about the broad socialists, not the narrow socialists. So I'll repeat this. The very existence of the broad socialist splinter was predicated on the idea that it is impossible and undesirable to produce a proletariat in order to then produce an authentic Marxism. This explains why the Bulgarian literature of the period did not produce anything more original than a 16-page long biography and outline of Marxist teaching written by Eftim Dabev and Grigor Chashmijiev. And this is in 1933. If one wants to study the reception of Marx in this period, one will be confronted mostly by the debates on applicability of Marxism rather than the application of Marx. Now I'll speak a little bit about the literature post-1944. The literature did see a continuation of this debate to a lesser extent in philosophical circles mostly, but the historical materialism methodology practically ended these debates. This does not mean that the applicability of Marxism didn't rule the day. On the contrary, it can even be seen as a compensatory reaction. The literature was dominated by a newly found enthusiasm in publishing and translating, now free from persecution. In fact, the importance of translation will remain central also throughout the 1970s and the 1980s at the ASSSM and Sofia University. Until the late 1940s, the literature of Bulgarian Marxism is also defined by ideologues of agrarian radicalism and autonomism, and one particular example is the work of Jacques Alshech. And Jacques Alshech sought to meet the agrarian ideology and Marxist political economy. So one reason why it is difficult to unearth the Bulgarian line of reading Capital in the aftermath of 1944, and I think this is the real interesting part, is that Marxist studies intertwined with the pauperization and censorship of the pre-1944 past in the making of communist historiography. The theoretical organ which served the purpose was the journal Historический прегляд, which published since 1945, which was by the Bulgarian Academy of Science and the Institute of History, and was dominated by the historian Alexander Bermov. Bermov's guidance and purchase in historical circles had to provide ample evidence for the introduction of class consciousness in historiography, which he delivered ad hoc. While the pre-1944 period was dominated by the issue of applicability of Marxism, the pre-1891 period was ignored as a wellspring of authentic Bulgarian class consciousness, as national liberation heroes had two diverse influences, so the communist historians couldn't make sense of that. The period will also remain understudied as one carrying the past of Narodnik, anarchist and nihilist elements coming from Russia in developing the right kind of class consciousness in Bulgarian liberation and revival processes, thereby either leading to rewriting communist biographies of national liberation heroes, such as Hristo Botev, or understudying others, such as Zahari Stoyanov. The Bulgarian Communist Party couldn't meaningfully organize all of these. After September 9, 1944, the First World War became a forbidden topic in Bulgarian historiography. Historical science had thus too sterile environment to historicize, and thus, as one historian observes, when it comes to class consciousness, this is Stefan Minkov. When it comes to class consciousness and Marxism in the interwar period, the historians at the University of Sofia, at that time the only educational institution in Bulgaria to offer courses and research on history, didn't work on topics related to the First World War. Historic research about the First World War was reduced to a minimum, and for a long time, interpretations did not go beyond cliché descriptions of the imperialistic nature of war. And this will remain true until the mid-70s in Bulgaria. The norm of Soviet historical materialism in Bulgarian historiography expanded to other fields of interest as well, especially in the field of philosophy. The best example pertains to the philosopher Dmitry Mikhalchev, who is now wrongly glorified as an anti-communist philosopher, but who partially accepted Histmat dogmas. For example, he accepted that history is progress and that historical cycles follow patterns of human activities. Mikhalchev did remain active until the late 40s, where he coexisted with Todor Pavlov in Sofia University, but the price he had to pay for his particular compromised Marxism, and it's a compromise in Bulgaria, so his compromised Marxism was to be publicly attacked and stained as revisionist in the philosophical press in the 1950s and the 1960s. A late example is a discussion documenting one debate between Dmitry Mikhalchev and Todor Pavlov on a 1963 publication on Hegel, which was a publication by Dmitry Mikhalchev, which reveals the party fervor and antagonism exercised. And I'm not going to go into quotations, I'm just mentioning this. Mikhalchev was neither an avid reader of Marx nor purely an anti-Marxist, but the orthodoxy of Todor Pavlov, who was now in power at the Institute of Philosophy at the Bulgarian Academy of Sciences, was relentless in its demonstrativity. There is no debate between Pavlov and his circles, and Mikhalchev and his circles on capital or issues pertaining to the analysis of capital's contradictions, etc. The debates are purely sociological. Mikhalchev advocated presentationism of the scientific object, easily identified with bourgeois idealism and anti-Leninist materialism, while Pavlov advocated a representative realism closer to a monistic mind-matter correspondence theory. It is analytical subtleties like this that reveal what was at stake for party ideologues like Pavlov, who were also chief philosophers in the country and dominated the day. Questions of concern were closer, at best, to Lenin's Marx. But the attack on Mikhalchev, as an example, was strictly speaking more instrumental than a conceptual attack. For Todor Pavlov, the real problem was not Mikhalchev's compromised Marxism slash Remkianism, which is contemporaneous to the rise of the dialectical materialism in Bulgaria, but the problem was that there is no place for such philosophy after the arrival of Michurin and Lysenko in the Bulgarian Academy, which happened in 1949. In 1949, there was a very big conference which introduced materialist genetics and Michurin and Lysenko. It is biological and not economic debates that put Mikhalchev off the radar of the admissible. In this period, after 1944, it's interesting to note also the influence of Alexander Leontief and his work, which was felt as introduced by his textbooks on political economy. So it is the same Alexander Leontief who the Johnson Forest tendency in the US targeted as one of those who have unconsciously admitted that the labor theory of value has ceased to operate in the USSR, more particularly in the Stakhanovite model of labor. To understand the lack of originality until the 1970s, when I think some sort of originality can be recognized in Bulgarian Marxism, in this particular state of the reception of Marx, we have to return to the history of the Stanky Dimitrov school, which then became ASSSM. I'm just going to speak about a brief look that I did at the bibliographical catalogue of the philosophical periodicals in Bulgaria. And some of those are, here are some of those that I consulted. Philosophska misl, the other one is Izvestia i nauchni trudove na Aonso. Aonso is the Bulgarian abbreviation of ASSSM, with the Central Committee of the Bulgarian Communist Party, Philosophical Series, and then the other is Philosophski pregled. And all of these bibliographical catalogues, they reveal very little about a particularly significant Bulgarian commentary on capital. So all the search I did and all the all of the research led to very scanty material. Unsurprisingly, on the other hand, looking up at the index of an interwar journal, such as Philosophski pregled, and the period here is different, it's 1929 till 1943, one finds only one publication on Marxism, and this publication is by Dmitry Mikhalchev, whom I just discussed, and who was attacked personally by Todor Pavlov. The alleged anti-systemic quality Pavlov and others such as Sava Ganovsky wanted to find in Mikhalchev was certainly out of touch, but this did not make him an anti-Marxist in any way. So without wanting to derogate the contributions of somebody like Pavlov and his famous theory of reflection, which after all defined the scientific snowboarding of dialectical materialism in the entire Soviet bloc and beyond, the relevant periodicals that I consulted reveal that original research and commentary began surfacing in the 1970s and intensified between the mid-1970s and the late 80s. Now I'll give two very interesting examples of how party and science work together in Bulgaria. And these examples are basically to illustrate the conceptual passivity of Bulgarian Marxism. The first example is this one. After the April plenum, the Institute of Philosophy at the Bulgarian Academy of Science organized a series of meetings in March-April 1956, spearheaded by a report from Radichev Karakolov called The Principles of Building a Program of Dialectical and Historical Materialism in Higher Education Institutions. Those long titles. The distinction between dogmatists and revisionists, with the latter suffocated and being exactly the ones who would have been allegedly able to produce original scholarship, not on the capital, but in general on Marx. So Tsatsov has studied this line, and which was centered around the work of Lysenko and Michurin, was in this process continued along the more specific lines of Histmat and its scientific and party role as organizing principle for the cultural creative intelligentsia. In Bulgaria, the intelligentsia was divided in two. There was the technical engineering intelligentsia, and the other one was called the cultural creative intelligentsia, philosophers, sociologists, etc. The Bulgarian sociologist Svetla Koleva has studied this in detail. At this particular meeting, one could detect the genesis of Soviet subservient Marxism as it produced two groups. The first one argued for the role of Histmat as part and parcel of Marxist-Leninist philosophy, which should be separated from Diamat. So this Histmat coincides with what would otherwise be Marxist sociology per se. The other group in that meeting, which eventually lost the debate, treated historical materialism within the systematization provided by dialectical materialism by arguing for a principle of convergence between logics and history. This division's result was that inasmuch as historical materialism is thought of as the Marxist science of society par excellence, there is no sociology proper. And yet, it is exactly in Bulgarian sociology where we will find original Marxist research, as I will show in a moment. The second event is a meeting of philosophical workers, which took place. Philosophical workers was an official title. It was actually a title that was actually used in the Bulgarian Academy. Took place on November 11, 1959, organized by the Science Education Arts Section of the Bulgarian Communist Party Central Committee. It was based on a decision of the 21st Congress of the KPSS, as well as a report by Dr. Zhivkov to the National Assembly and a report of the same year on the development of science. These meetings saw the cracks open between dogmatists and revisionists centered around the schools of idealism. This would be Weismann in genetics and materialism, Lysenko in genetics as well. A fierce debate opened between Weismannism in, whether Weismannism is idealism. As with Mihalchev, the problem was the following. Is it possible to make an already existing current, in this case Weismannism, cohabitate with dialectical materialism? And the answer was no. So the Weismannists, unlike Lysenko, lost this debate. So this leads me to a short discussion. And I think this is the most important part of the presentation. After that, I guess I have time to go to the conclusions. To a short discussion of Marxism as and in Bulgarian sociology, where we can actually find something that we can deem original Bulgarian Marxism that is not necessarily mediated by Soviet Marxism. And this was spearheaded in the early 60s by Zhivkov Shavkov. Peter Edmil Mitev, who is another very famous Bulgarian Marxist, notes that the paradox to which people like Zhivkov would respond later was that, I quote, that the ideological setting of the 1930s, a conflictual period in the history of the Kingdom of Bulgaria, turned out to be more favorable for the creative freedom of the Marxists, such as Ivan Hajiski, than the dogmatic setting under the dominance of Marxism-Leninism that Zhivkov Shavkov faced, end of quote. This is the time of Todor Zhivkov in his mid-age, who, as one scholar describes him, has been a consistent loyalist voice denying the possibility of genuine communism apart from the Soviet model and apart from Soviet leadership. This was, of course, registered in scientific activities much earlier. For example, the example I gave with Lysenkovism in 1949, and eventually led to an opposition between sociology as bourgeois science versus historical materialism and scientific communism, which was already seen as a science of society par excellence. So the opposition was sociology and his math. But from the late 1950s onwards, which saw the division between dogmatists and revisionists, communists' own proprioception in Bulgarian science registered as its great successes, I quote again from Tsatsov, geological science, so geological science was the great success in Bulgarian Marxism, which helped to find and utilize in an industry new resources as well as biological sciences. The biggest number of philosophical worker was in the area of biology, end of quote. This kind of obscures sociology further as to this very day, a strain within the Bulgarian sociology is more adequately described as critical theory or even philosophical sociology rather than electoral sociology or sociology of labor. Rosharkov tried to do something like sociology of labor actually. So Živko Rosharkov and somebody else, Jacques Natan, they made sure that they will develop a distinct sociology of labor in 1969 at the Higher Institute of Economy, Karl Marx in Bulgaria. The vanguard of research here is empirical data, which was so in need under the eye of the Communist Party's dogmaticism. One specific way in which others have followed the footsteps of Živko Rosharkov in this particular case, and the arrival of empirical data in sociology, against party-line dogmaticism is the work on the behavior of young people. So this was a particular phenomenon in Bulgarian sociology in the 1960s. For example, Peter Emil Mitev took up the Institute for the Young, People of the Bulgarian Science Academy in 1967 and 8, and carried as a new method the so-called indirect poll. And what he did was extremely interesting. He decided that he would publish in a journal and then sent out this journal to many students and meet with many students a questionnaire that Jenny Marx wrote to his father. And then he used this questionnaire to gather information about the emotional response of young people in Bulgaria at the late 60s. So this was a relative relaxation in practicing social science after the dramatic 1950s, which offered a politically instrumentalized version of Marxism. This version of Marxism could be explained by two things. First is the neglect of the pre-1891 and the interwar periods, where no pure ideological sources of inspiration were found by the nomenclatura. The second thing is the lack of disciplinary tradition before the First World War, the example I gave with Minkov. As with the case of genetics, a debate on sociology versus histmat from the 1950s onwards followed. And this evidence is published in the book by Svetla Koleva, Diana Ninkova, and Simona Trenova. So they carried out several interviews. They carried out a lot of interviews with Bulgarian sociologists from the time, and I'm going to give some really interesting examples from this now. And quotations by Bulgarian sociologists of the time who responded to party-line dogmaticism. In his interview, Kirill Vasiliev says the following, that we developed a sociology as science without prejudice. Capital is all right, the economic manuscripts there are okay too. What ideology is there? While the Communist Manifesto is ideology, its entire pathos is ideological. End of quote. Vasiliev refers to the period after 1957 and Khrushchev's so-called secret speech. As Stefan Domchev says, Marxism was the state ideology until 1955 for the Todor Pavlovs and his movement, the Marxism-Leninism, end of quote. And Stoyan Mikhailov states that we wanted to integrate a real Marxist approach and a real Marxist atmosphere in the party. Apparently, Bulgarian sociologists saw potential to do so by wanting to engage with capital in some ways. Mikhailov further states that the most unfortunate dogma in Bulgarian scientific communism and Marxism was the idea that capitalism is incapable of development. Others from the younger generation, such as Chardar Kuranov, claimed there was no feeling of oppression by the ideology, but the oppression from the party bureaucracy. Mintrosemov, and his observation is also very crucial. He claimed that the specific research work was destroying dogmaticism. So the arrival of empirical data was already a sort of rebellion against party line dogmaticism. According to Semov, the dogmaticism was the byproduct of Bukharin's thesis that historical materialism is science proper, and that therefore there is no need for sociology as there is already scientific communism, and therefore the identity with Histmann. It seems that over time, those sociologists who disagreed with the identity of sociology with Histmann, dominated by the March-April 1956 events, found ways to subvert Soviet-style formalism. Perhaps most importantly, Zakhary Stoikov claims that Marxism was devoid of the most, this is what I found to be perhaps the most crucial thing about Bulgarian Marxism as a particular derivative of Soviet Marxism. And he claims Marxism was devoid of the most important teaching of Marx, surplus value. And here it is worth recalling the following. Raya Donevska, who was one of the representatives of the Johnson Forest tendency, she actually, as I mentioned earlier, attacked Leontief and his way of streamlining Marxist political economy in the capital. And Donevska said the following. So I'm going to give you this quote by Donevska, which actually works very well with this observation by Zakhary Stoikov. When Donevska was criticizing Leontief, she said the following. With the demand for a theory of value that was not at the same time a theory of surplus value, the Stalinists tried to divest the labor theory of value of its class content, end of quote. Put in relative scientific isolation, Bulgarian sociologists of the period observed the same phenomenon, and hence Stoikov comment that society becomes wealthier only if it works more, which sounds quite crazy for a Marxist when you think about it now, but in the context of claiming that surplus value theory is missing, it makes sense. Because wealth equals surplus value, which is what Marxists under Bulgarian socialism want to get rid of, end of quote. And indeed, one of the few articles I found from the 1960s which deals with capital directly is a translation of Soviet scholar Shaptulin, and it doesn't engage with surplus value theory at all. I'm gonna perhaps skip this part, and I'm gonna speak now briefly, this is the last part, I'm gonna speak about the particular originality of Bulgarian sociology as Marxism. And this particular line is also very important because it's a very old mongrel between sociology and philosophy, which was a platform of bypassing party line dogmaticism. So another way in which Bulgarian sociology managed to salvage Marx and be original is also to some extent due to the work of Zhivko Oshavkov. As Stefan Donchev says, Oshavkov managed to connect the systemic approach and in fact the structural functional one with Hegel with his greater logic, which is actually the systematic approach. Marx uses the systemic approach, and he, that is to say Oshavkov, struggled to prove that he derives from Marx so that he is not blamed about Weberianism, which was sort of unthinkable at the time, that you would apply Weberian theory. Similarly, Viktor Samuilov, another sociologist, says that back in the 1960s, he decided to pursue philosophy after he graduated from political economy because in order to understand capital, you have to understand Hegel's logic. And that's the influence of Oshavkov. Later representatives of Bulgarian sociology will nurture a particular and dear relationship to the logic of Hegel, yet not always in order to either praise Marx or merely divert productively from party lines to save their personal and professional spaces. As one scholar, Baskin, has observed on the late 80s in Bulgaria, he claims the following, Zhivkov's ancien regime began to decay and a genuine Bulgarian critical Marxism emerged as an effort to revive the spirit of opposition and mass movement within the Bulgarian Communist Party, end of quote. So the decisive line of original research should be credited to one historical event. This was, as far as I know, a relatively unorganized and unplanned visit by the Georgian Soviet then philosopher Merapon Mardashvili in Bulgaria in the late 70s. I think it was 1978. And this is, maybe it sounds uninteresting, but in fact this if sometimes events like this can turns out can frame for decades to come Bulgarian sociology in this particular case. And there he spoke to the younger generation of sociologists and left an imprint in Bulgarian sociological and Marxist culture, leaving an old sociological reception that would slowly help emancipate Marxist scholarship. So in particular, this was due to his writing on so-called non-classical rationality and one particular article on Marx's verwandelte Formen, converted forms. There was already an interest in the faculty of philosophy in the work of Ewald Ilyenkov and his dialectical logic, and Ilyenkov and Mamardashvili did know each other pretty well. I should have about 15 minutes more, right? We started. Okay, right. What I'm gonna do now is move towards Bulgarian contemporary Marxisms, why I wanted to finish this particular period until 1990 with the influence of this particular line, on the one hand Hegel, on the other hand Mamardashvili, is just as an introduction to the state of affairs now. One of the people who then met Merab Mamardashvili is the Bulgarian sociologist and theoretician Dejan Dejanov. He took up the project of rewriting, so this is actually his life. Sort of project of rewriting the logic of the capital on the basis of Merab Mamardashvili's reading and Ilyenkov's dialectical logic in a series of scattered articles that appeared mostly in the 1990s. The defining point was the intellectual production of what was called in the 1980s the Marx Seminar. It was a sort of informal seminars that was circulating in different people's apartments, not in the university. Okay, so now I'm going to move to post-1990 Bulgarian Marxism and give you my conclusion to the research that I'm presenting. In general, I do not think that a serious scholar, based on what I presented, can claim that there is a particularly original reception of capital and political and Marxist political economy in the Bulgarian literature, both before and after 1990, but with some caveats. The pre-1990 literature in general, in the two periods that I outlined, and with the notable exceptions of the logicians and the phenomenologists and some representatives such as Mitev of the sociology of young people, this can easily fall into the label of what Svetla Koleva calls orthodox Marxism-based discourse, which treats from his perspective of sociology issues such as forms of social development, social laws, the structure of Marxist-Leninist science, all devoid of empirical data. Okay. So, just briefly, the Bulgarian Marxism obviously is not a Marxism anymore, it's rather Marxism. These are some of the major publications that I think are important to mention throughout the transition. I think what's interesting about this period in general is that if you listen to liberal historiography of the transition and anti-communist or even social democrats, you will get the feeling that there hasn't been any continued interest in Marxism proper or Marx as a single author proper, which actually isn't the case. What I did was do some research in the library with especially Filosofski alternativi and Novo Vreme, and actually the scientific interest in Marx is uninterrupted throughout the 90s. The literature changed, the paradigms changed, certain authors like even orthodox Marxists like Lukács were published in Bulgaria, mind you, but in general there is an uninterrupted interest. What happens is that you can say that post-2008, of course, the sort of particular attention to Marxism is circulating, but in general, the liberal advantage of losing interest in Marx is untenable. Okay. So before I go to ICSI, or maybe I should go directly to ICSI, and then I'll go to the conclusions. The end of the 1980s did see an increase in the interest, especially in the of research of the young Marx. The young Marx was at the book topics, the philosophical and economical manuscripts in Bulgaria. They were published in Bulgarian in the 1980s, but the only way this text was circulating was a specialized Russian edition from the 1955. So it was a very esoteric text in Bulgarian Marxism. However, there was a general decrease in interest in Marx altogether in the 1980s. For example, if you look at Godishnik of Sofisky Universitet, Filosofsky Fakultet, in the period 1981-2010, which I did, I found 7 works, dissertation and articles on Marx, which is an extremely low number, because the period included 1981 till 1990. The interest in the young Marx was anthologized in two books. But now I want to just mention, and I think this is the most important contemporary reception of Marx in Bulgaria, the so-called Institute for Critical Social Studies, or I call it with the Bulgarian abbreviation ICSI, Institut za kritički socijalni izgledovanja, which was founded in the early 80s by people like Dejan Dejanov, Andrei Rajev and others, and these are the people I mentioned with regards to Hegel and Mamardashvili. They have a specific interest in developing phenomenological sociology, history of technologies, networks and actor network theory. Significantly, if ICSI can be now credited as an original outlet of Marxist interpretation, this is at the expense of another post-communist popularization of Marx. That is, Dejan Dejanov in particular does claim that labor theory of value is now irrelevant, though not for the revisionist reasons and motives that most scholars would suppose. This rejection is the byproduct of ICSI members and their studies in the 1980s at the Faculty of Philosophy on structures of everyday life. ICSI is now the institutional outlet of what used to be called the Marx Seminar from the 1980s, whose principal topic has always been everyday life, as well as so-called secondary network, the problem of consumption, and writing a critical history and theory of technologies. In light of the rather reformist and obscurely quasi-postmodern research agenda, which is pursued by ICSI members, Andrei Rajev, I'm going to show you some quotations. Sorry, I missed this slide. This is the literature by ICSI that I think is important. So now I'm just going to give you a couple of examples about this weird Marxist revisionism that runs in Bulgarian Marxism nowadays by Andrei Rajev and Dejan Dejanov. For example, Rajev, in his most perspicacious comments, reveals surprising adherence to Engels rather than Marx. And I quote, "There are social structures because, I repeat, there are recurrent natural processes. Orthodox Marxism describes this as follows: the productive forces determine the relations of production, or the objects are an embodiment of social relations." Rajev can also be credited as one of the few writers that have actually discussed under late socialism Marx's theory of machines, which the West knows well because of the Italian reception of Grundrisse. Though Rajev's work is concerned with writing a wrong that he sees in the theory. Namely, Rajev claims that Marx failed to see in machines a historical distinction between means and objects. This is a particular example of the influence that the work on Hegel's logic has exerted on the reception of Marx. Why? Because Rajev says that machines are past manufacture. And by saying this, he is mirroring Hegel's notion of essence, which he is calling has-beenness. I forgot what was the German word for that. Dejanov is a student of Rajev and now a very influential Bulgarian sociologist also. He wrote an afterword to Rajev's work and now he lectures at Plovdiv University. So he says that, let me just go to that. So commenting on Rajev's works, he says, Rajev's work on socialized natural processes, he says, carries a newer type of pessimism and hence popularization of the theory under the banner of technological transition. So he says that those processes are the alpha and omega of human history, which is Rajiv's thesis, is the non-classical discovery that triggers the chain reaction of all implications which lead to both Marx's critique of political economy and critical theory in general of their modernistic dogmas. Now I'm going to go to my conclusions. So in general, one can claim that there is no significant and the key word here is systematic Bulgarian contribution to the study of capital in a sense that will define Bulgarian science and party development by the power of officially sanctioned world outlooks. The above discussion that I provided reveals very little about the reception of capital, therefore political economy. And where there is a reception of Marx, not of capital, it is hardly the Marx of capital. And when there is such a reception of the Marx of capital, the original feature of the theory, in this case Raichev and Dejanov, that I just discussed, the original feature of their theory is in fact a revisionist theory of labor theory of value, which, however, is not because of anti-communist sentiments. So these are not anti-communist sociologists. However, the interest in logic, as well as the sociology of young people in late socialism, in the 1960s, and the short-lived flare of Marxian humanism in the 1980s at Sofia University, did produce a distinct and partially original reception of Marx, which has its repercussions today. For example, the social circle Haspel that I belong to and the group New Left Perspectives does maintain a close relationship with ICSI representatives as well as other university professors, and there was a sort of like attempt at continuity with the so-called Marx seminar for the last several years, with seminars organized for reading Capital Volume 1 and 2. Generally, the scientific appeal and use of capital and political economy in Bulgaria was ornamental for the party lines, which elevated Marxism to a living ideology and scientific measure of all human activity. And this human activity was measured only in its party dimensions. Yet, beyond this ornamental ideologization, it is difficult to prove the influence of capital as an influential pool of ideas that fed into original analysis, particularly from historical and philosophical perspectives. Given the influence of the German and Swiss federative and Marxist circles on Bulgarian politics early in the 19th century, and given Blagojev and his dubious attitude towards Russia as a higher force of liberation, it is really, really weird that the Bulgarian perception of Marx ended up so informed of this holier-than-thou loyalty of Bulgarians is a psychological one. And it has to do with the idea that Bulgaria was a small country which was surrounded by unfriendly neighbors, including a vacillating Romania. The conclusion can only be that the Bulgarian Communist Party did neglect the idea for originality of a Bulgarian reception, particularly in and after 1956, to then produce an automated series of gestures of loyalty to the USSR in pursuit of scientific rigor, representing itself as intellectual camaraderie. The official adoption and implementation of Marxist-Leninism as a state ideology, together with the constitutionally secured leading role of the Bulgarian Communist Party, led to a regression in the quality and independent nature of the Bulgarian reception of Marxism that was once given during the time of Blagojev. This comment that I'm doing is not a Russophobic comment, as I do not deem the Russian Soviet influence inherent degenerative onto Bulgarian Marxism. After all, USSR Marxism was highly original. All the more so since both Blagojev and Pavlov were strongly embraced in Russia, respectively in politics and theory. If Bulgarian Marxism was seen as a politically instrumental extension of Soviet Marxism, this might of course qualify my own assessment as a nationalistic one. Yet, internationalism doesn't mean subjugation. True, there were several heated debates on the pages of Philosophska Misl and journals like Novo Vreme that were heated by Todor Pavlov regarding the epistemological limitations of Marxism. Yet, these are not engagements with capital per se. These were engagements with sociology and biology. After 1990, the three levels of reception, theoretical, practical, and by the masses, These three levels remained relatively independent and unconnected. To quote the conclusion by another Bulgarian scholar, Emilia Minova, she says, as a result, over the years, a never-widening gap could be registered between ideological practice and Marxist theory, end of quote. The fact that the major volumes featuring commentaries and interpretations of Marx in Bulgarian language are unoriginal editions, they are all commemorative editions, 100 years of this, 100 years of that, and that those are not necessarily focused on political economy and capital, is telling of the level of intellectual engagement transcending the party orthodoxy or being passionate about it. And there is very little that can be deemed actually an interpretation of political economy or else. And this is why we don't have much of a choice other than saying that Bulgarian Marxism is, this is not my phrase, this is the phrase of a scholar who works on Bulgaria, Baskin, who says the Bulgarian Marxism is incorporative tradition. He calls it an incorporative tradition. And we can just embrace this conclusion of Baskin and leave it at that. Thank you.